After your name, followed by the pound sign. You will now.
Hey, my name is Victor, and I'm working in the National Lab for Nowcast and Remote Sensing. This morning, we would like to present an album. The title, Interactive Algorithm to Nowcast Snow Far Away from Lake Event Snow using both satellite and model data. So, okay, go to the next page. The objective is very straightforward to present of this presentation is to present a algorithm to allow cast low far away from effect slow using both set and model data. And outline of my presentation first to describe a little bit of background on the Lake Effect Snow score. And here a methodology of this algorithm. We present some results and the conclusion and future works. So, as from the previous presenter, sometimes the snow score can be quite very significant. And so the impact of lake effect snow, heavy lake effect snow bank can pose a very significant weather hazard to the public, airport shutdown and dangerous driving conditions. Like for example, in this case, on December 7th and 10th in London, so very snow, over a meter snow in 24 hours. Snow, we mostly with numerical model, in particular measure scale modeling. However, still like because like the snow bands can be very low, kilometers, several kilometers. And microphysical properties of the snow is not still well understood, in particular the snow liquid waste. And very often we do loud casting of lake effect snow using satellite radar and surface observation. Satellite can help you to find the snow band, multi band, single band. Like you can only look at the cow top in those given channel from the ghost east or west, and very often it's overshooting the top, and because the snow band is very kilometer 2 kilometers, and so often the estimate the snow amount and observation have only limited observation. Vessel over like Canada, and not enough service observation. So the real-time estimation of the snowfall rate from lake from snow the topic of what is happening. The interactive algorithm to allow cast snow far away from lake effect snow. So is the algorithm first takes a faster input on snow bank location and use both the satellite and model data to catch snow far away along a snow band. So a better allow cast of away to help improve warning and alert the public. This is the side view of a snow band, and you can see the all begin with a small cumulus, and so as the cumulus moves downstream, clouds getting thicker and the top getting higher, and so the temperature will get cooler and cooler. Okay, what the satellite is telling is for, at the infrared channel, and cloud top temperature. The cloud temperature change as the cumulus move downstream. So -2, -5, -12, etc. So actually what is the telling you actually is the time evolution of the cloud cooling. We can call to the cooling rate. Okay. So there is a line of slope squall viewed from a satellite is actually a snapshot of the evolution of the cumulus from the initial to the mature stage. And dynamic forcing that generates a snow effect snow squall by the cutoff cooling range, which implies the ascent rate during the developing stage. Snowballing of the snow squall is determined by air mass ascent rate, available moisture, liquid ratio, thickness of cloud, dry air entrainment, and possible factors. But in algorithms, we ignore the dry air entrainment and other effects. Okay. And the strategy, there's a couple of steps, 5 steps. The first and second step is listed here. So the first step is very simple. So we need the forecaster's expert judgment to identify the snow squall. Okay. For example, in this just a, you can identify many snow bands, but this I only use 5 here for this case. Like, let's look at the radar, satellite, and the boundary layer wind to identify the snow squall. In our workstation, the linear, you can use map object, or in the Aurora nowcasting system, you can always align. Where's my mouse? On the snow band, and the lat-long location, a pair long location along the snow band, and this first satellite data at the infrared channel, and then the cutoff temperature as a function of distance. Okay, so graph on the right is the cutoff temperature change with distance. You can this set is the cumulus developing development stage. So the cumulus growth, the cutoff temperature is cooling, and reach the bar. So the stop, like for this case, of course, kind of noisy, the data, because it is a break in here. So this step, basically, we want to calculate the DTDX, that's a temperature gradient, along the developing section of the snow squall. Okay, this the line over here. So from moving average to get the average slope here, DTDX, for this case, my 2.26 degree per kilometer. This can later be converted into the cooling rate. Step 3, so the model standing data at different points of snow, along the snow squall, okay? Like here, for example, let's look at the blue lights, for example. So let the forecast draw a line along the end, get standing data from the regional model at different points along the snow squall. So the purpose is first, we want to grab the modified air temperature parcel, okay, to the equilibrium level. Equilibrium level is not the model from the model, but we use the satellite device temperature, and then we can calculate or we can grab the satellite the saturated lapse rate for the sounding data, and we can cloud thickness, precipitation liquid, and boundary layer wind. For calculation of slow rate, first we already know the temperature gradient DTDX from the step on the development step of the slow squall with the cutoff cooling rate, the temperature gradient with the boundary layer with U, and calculate the mean saturated adiabatic lapse rate with the boundary layer come from the sounding data. Okay, so the is used to calculate the vertical velocity. So dt dt gamma the v. And calculate condensed water from the equilibrium level to the from the L to the equilibrium level at the vertical moisture first at different point along the snow score. So this is simply Q times the vertical velocity. And we can clearly the snowfall weight at different point along the snow squall up the shoreline for this step, okay? That is so intense, it's the vertical moisture flux times the snow liquid ratio. The snow weight along this green bolded green line here, all along the line at this stage, okay? Now, the snow to liquid ratio used is 1 to 15. Along 1 to 10 must be 1. I use arbitrary number 1 to 15, and then something to need further work to have a better snow liquid ratio. But for use 1 to 15, but you always celebrate the final result using different snow liquid ratio. And the indoor weight modification, okay? That is, snow move inland, you will modify because from the lake, the moisture heat transfer from the lake. So we usually snow weight decrease as we move inland. So this graph here again. So again, the countertop temperature change at first distance. So it had the coastline over here, which is corresponding to the point O. So we already calculated at this point in step 4. Okay. Now, inland distance, we say any point X and here, for example, it's point X here. Okay. So point O, you already know the snow weight, which is less than O. And then temperature, these are O, and LCL temperature, TL, okay? In any point X inland, so we have the snow weight SX and the outdoor temperature TX and the CL temperature TLCL. Okay. Now, the weight at any point X inland along the snow bed is parameterized. Okay, you cannot calculate this ratio. It's a simple parameterization method. F sub 0 times this fraction TLCL minus TX over my T sub 0. What is that? Like, the temperature when the snow is moving inland, with the temperature getting warmer, which means the snow weight will be diminished. But aside, if the color temperature getting cold, it means maybe you have other effects in place and the weight will be higher. So, kind of primary. Type this to the snow weight near the shoreline. Okay. How will this algorithm? First, I identify snow squall. Input. What is the lat non of the snow band? And we take in the satellite data. And with a program to generate the countertop hour temperature along the slope band, and then we get temperature function distance, and then we can calculate the dT dx. And we use the data combined, we calculate the all kinds of parameters. Okay, but most important with the snow weight along the slope band, so this can be tabular output or graphical output. And apply the different lake effects snow cases. December 7, 2010 and 2015. There is a case that we have London. We have a lot of snow in London. City shut down. So the and we identify Of course, you can draw more, but I just use for the most E identified for and just try to test the algorithm. Okay. We're on the blue line, the snow score by the blue line, which through two stations. The station WGD and then the London station YU. Okay. The book shows the 6 out of 4 amount from 18 to 00 session, and that the coverage done at 18 set using the satellite data at 18:15 set, and 04 amount is from 18 to 00 set. So from the radar, you can see that the heaviest snow is always along near the coast. Okay, and that the radar for this case is underestimated the snowfall because the we have 2 to 3 meters per 6 hours. But of course, for this case, it's a lot heavier. And left hand side, this graph shows the snowfall the result. Vertical axis is snowfall rate. That's 10 inches snowfall rate, okay, centimeter per hour. This is the distance. And see that, like, for all snow bands, as fall rate increase with distance to the shoreline and then decrease greatly in general. Okay. Also, in the mean partial velocity and the algorithm. And for this case, the vertical speed ranging from 0.31 to 0.6 meters per second. Okay, I read a lot of literature, and from the they use a lot of business signal modeling to model the lake effect snow. I compare the number; they're quite consistent. So. Let's focus on the blue line here. The blue line, this one. Okay. So that's the snow pass through Gorge and London. Okay, compared with the Gorge observation. And the observation for 2 hour period and causing the time the calculation. And for this case, 17 to 19 snow, because the snow weight can change quite dramatically from hour to hour. So 2 hours to compare. So for this case, it's overestimated the snow weight at cottage, okay? Because 3 centimeters at cottage, but all I have is 9 centimeters per hour. But for the amount rate, from 17 to 19 centimeters, 18 is 1 centimeter, from 18 to 19 is 6 centimeters. So, the evidence calculation is within that range, and again, I use snow bands and focusing with the blue line again, which passed through WGD and YXU, and the below is the 6 out of 4. This one. I get confused. This is the next one. The case is on December 8, 2010 at 12:15 set. So I draw 4 snow bands and test the test the algorithm. So the blue band pass through London, the white band pass through WGD, and the 6 hour snowfall over and it's underestimated was indicated in this graph here. You can see that and the snow weight for the wet blue is increasing very significantly with distance near and then decrease moving inland. Then wet line here and first I kind of such the snow weight by the ops several times Gorge reporting, in fact, very heavy snow for that hour. But any ops from 12, but from 12 to 13, they have approximately 9 centimeters. So, we're suggesting also very heavy snow, but short. So, the snow weight increasing quite dramatically with distance, and inland it drops. And then, but artificial, because here this cloud top is a lot cooler, And we have some high count moving through. This algorithm doesn't work when you have a high count layers. So I haven't worked out on it yet. We need to use another method, just based on model, equilibrium level, something like that. But I won't talk about this. But anyway, artificial. Otherwise, the slope will be around 3 nanometers, and leave it 2 to 3 like that. So, how much? I want to skip this one and look at the other one here. And I have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 snow band identified. It. In case we have a very heavy snow band, move right to London, as indicated from the radar imagery. Here's graph. You can see the again snow rate increase with distance, and up to the solar line. And look at the fire. Past London, which was at this time. And, London is the snow is pretty consistent, from 12.4 centimeter, 12 to 13. That is less than 3 centimeters. So it is, for this case, it's underestimated. This winter, 2013 at 5:50, again, three snow bands. It's probably like look at the high version model, the GLOMW model, and indicating there's a band over here. The snow way is nice. On the left here is the high resolution model, the GLOMW 925 millibar vertical velocity and 1.3 meter per second. So this band corresponds to this here, this precipitation. And the radar, you can see that like the mode, they tell you something, but sometimes they don't identify every band. Okay? And indicating this graph here. And so the red and green, which pass through the London and Greenwich, and in general speaking, they're pretty consistent with observed the light snow they reported 1 centimeter, less than 1 centimeter. So with the model calculated vertical speed along this band here, with my mean partial vertical velocity, like for example for this here, meter per second for the model correspond to the red line here. It's 0.4 meters per second, and what the model suggests. But I like this because I think the model often underestimate the intensity of the big event snow squall. So interactive algorithm to forecast this input on snow band's location with satellite data to produce a better nowcast of snow weight from lake effect snow. The is several snow squall events and produce some statistics. Of course, more testing can be done. If some improved warnings and the public are heavy snow squall. Rainbow snowband locations. Experiment to find snowband. The calculation and result. Okay. To include a more visible slow liquid ratio scheme in the algorithm. That's the hard part, because the slow liquid ratio time. And high resolution model test is to use more observation for evaluation sessions. This is a reference question. So, done.
Question for Victor. Douglas. I just wondered about the perils of trying to validate a convective parameter with a point four with a point verification,
mm-hmm.
because you may be thinking that you're not getting good results. But let's say London had your algorithm said an hour,
mm-hmm.
and London only got two, but you know, that could be a kilometer or two away. They could get 7 centimeters. So
yeah.
I'm just you're being harsh on yourself. Maybe the results would. But when you try to validate a point fork by using a point forecast, it's always going to be a problem.
Yeah, but we don't have level observation, right? That's why I think like sometimes the forecast is very important to identify the slope band. Sometimes I may not be joined correctly, maybe a little bit, a few kilometers away, and it'll be different. Okay? And so.
This is Justin in Gaylord, Michigan. It looks really promising for some of our offices that deal with lake effect that really don't have the radar coverage over some of our forecast areas where lake effect may be ongoing and you know you have radar estimates there and sometimes those radar estimates are you know they're just missing the lake effect altogether. You know a good example for us here in Gaylord is Sault Ste. Marie where on our things our radar doesn't see that lake effect at all and I think that. That could exist for quite a few offices around, and you know, if we could, do something along the lines of what you're looking at there, I think it would be a better first guess sometimes than purely looking at high resolution model data.
Yeah, thank you.